Good evening. This has been one of the most exciting days in my life, besides marrying my husband and having my children and grandchild. So if I am too excited, you know why. We have had a great research day today. More than 450 people showed up. And now, of course, we have had our first anniversary, 35th anniversary, to celebrate. So it is my pleasure to co-host this event with the 35th Anniversary Celebration Committee and to welcome all of you to Boston's great public university, the University of Massachusetts, Boston. It's great to be here with you as we mark the 35th anniversary of the College of Nursing and Health Sciences. I am especially grateful to the members of the 35th Anniversary Celebration Committee for their voluntary leadership and their efforts in putting this event together. Thanks to them, we can celebrate this wonderful milestone here tonight. And would the members of the committee stand up and be recognized? Thank you. I would like to begin by welcoming the family, friends, colleagues of our award recipients, Samantha White, Patricia Noga, Susan Gavagan, and Timothy Quigley. Thank you to all of you for coming here tonight. I would also like to take this time to the members of the University of Massachusetts Boston's College of Nursing and Health Sciences Advisory Board members who are here with us tonight. We're joined by Barbara Blakeney, Ed Campanero, Ann Gross, Audrey Jacy, Timothy Quigley, Karen Burns White, and our founding dean, Dr. Ann Kibrick. Thank you for your service and your ongoing support of the college. At this time, I would also like to take a special moment to remember Dr. Michael Foley. Mike served as chair of the advisory board and passed away suddenly this past December. He was a great friend, supporter, and a family member. He really received me with wide arms and warm heart. Before his passing, Michael and his wife, Anne, established the Dr. and Mrs. Michael T. Foley Student Success Award here at the university. Scholarships truly make a difference in the life of our nursing students, many of whom juggle full class schedules, hands-on learning experiences in local hospitals, and full or part-time jobs. Michael and Anne understood the importance of supporting our students to relieve some of the burden of tuition and fees so that they can focus on their nursing preparation more effectively. Since his passing in December, the Dr. and Mrs. Michael T. Foley Fund has received 116 gifts, totaling over $18,250, bringing the overall fund total to $80,812. Here with us tonight, we have Mike's wife, Anne, his children, Michael Jr., Patrick and Elizabeth, and his sisters, Mary Alice Foley and Judith Manneman. Thank you for joining us this evening to remember your husband, father, brother, great friend, and all the wonderful things he did for the university. Lastly, I would also like to give special recognition of our retired faculty and staff members who are here with us tonight. We're joined by Ethel Kanaxis, Fran Partno, Myron Segelman, and our founding dean, Dr. Ann Kibrick. You and your colleagues have laid the foundation of the College of Nursing and Health Sciences, and without your wisdom, hard work, and perseverance, we would not have been here where we are today. We thank you for all that you have done and all that you continue to do to support the university. Rosanna. Did you get the flowers? Okay. It is now my pleasure to introduce the Provost and Vice Chancellor for Academic Affairs, Winston Langley. Provost Langley is the senior administrator in charge of advancing the University of Massachusetts Boston's academic mission and the quality of its intellectual life. A scholar with a rich, diverse academic background and a seasoned administrator, he has been instrumental in defining and developing UMass Boston's identity as a student-centered, urban, public research university with a teaching soul. As provost and vice chancellor, Dr. Langley oversees all colleges, academic departments, research centers and institutes, and libraries. He supervises the university's ambitious research agenda and its expanding commitment to long-term faculty and student development. A former member of the Boston State College faculty, he has served the university in a number of senior administrative roles as a professor of political science and international relations since 1982. Dr. Langley's scholarly interests include human rights, alternative models of world order, religion, and politics. In addition, he is the rock of the College of Nursing and Health Sciences. We love having him as our provost. Ladies and gentlemen, Provost Langley.
It is difficult to follow an introduction of that sort. I do not know I'm deserving of it, but thank you, Dean Kulwicki. Good evening to all of us. The purpose of the 35th anniversary event is to highlight the many accomplishments of the College of Nursing and Health Sciences. And to do so and look at these accomplishments since the inception of the college in 1978, and to bring together influential leaders, partners, advocates, those present at the creation, and to cultivate further and engage our supporters. Among the influential leaders with us tonight is our keynote speaker for the evening. You already have her resume, and so I will not repeat it, except to say she's an alumna of the University of Massachusetts Boston, and as well of our College of Nursing and Health Sciences. She is also the current chair of the college's advisory board. Among the many things that the resume discloses is that she has had a history of successful leadership. But leadership as you well know, cannot succeed in isolation. To lead well, one must have partners, and one has only to examine carefully her resume to see how impressively it is laden with the partners with whom she has worked. Whether she were working with the American Nurses Association, the National Advisory Board of the Joint Commission on Accreditation, or with the World Health Organization, or with the Institute for Medicine, among others. One could also point to her initiative. To be a distinguished leader, one must have initiative. Once again, one finds that she is a person who sees what must be done and moves to do so. Hence, among other areas of her doing so, we find her founding Boston Healthcare for the Homeless Program and the Massachusetts Association of Registered Nurses. She also was the founding president of the Massachusetts Nurses Foundation. The many recognitions she has had, one of the 100 most influential and powerful persons in healthcare, for example, attest to the acknowledged effectiveness of her leadership. But I would contend that the astounding range of her interest and the giving, and in my view, a central part of effective leadership is that of giving, suggest three other areas of leadership attributes with which he is associated. One is a love of learning. I just had a chance to chat with her as I was coming through the door, and part of what I discovered, well, she's a part of those who believe in the adventures of learning. And how one may learn within systems, as it were. There is no greater need for that form of leadership as the world moves from separate political entities into an emerging single global society with multiple cultural differences. The second point is empathy. And one may say, as is often supposed, that this attribute has to do with the entering into the feelings and the fears and the exuberance and concerns of others. I think there is another attribute which is frequently overlooked and that is present in this person tonight. It is the capacity to anticipate vulnerability and to respond to it. It's a central feature of great leadership. And the third element is what I'm calling capaciousness, a certain roominess, you see, a space for others, a capacity to entertain within that space the connectedness of things, the contradictions of things. And think in terms of the human body itself and the human spirit as factors that bear on one's body and on one's health. We are a university committed to inclusive learning, doing and being. Empathy and capaciousness and adventures in learning, the very heart of that which we seek to represent. And they are the central attributes of nursing. We are therefore especially proud of welcoming all of us tonight to what we see as an event offered in the spirit of inclusiveness, and to welcome a speaker who is one of our own and who embodies inclusiveness, including the animals, whose often tender bonds with humans are misunderstood, and which she is in the process of studying. It is my pleasure to present to you Barbara Blakeney.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you, Provost Lyonley, for such a gracious introduction. I have 20 minutes to get into trouble here tonight. Let me begin by showing you a couple of videos. I think they speak for themselves, but we'll start with this one, an all-time favorite of mine. I love this video because it does exactly what you all just did, which is laugh. And the interesting thing about this is, if this gentleman had asked the question, how can I, as a blind person, drive a motorcycle? The answer would have been, I really can't. But obviously, that's not the question he asked himself, or he wouldn't have done that. I think the question he asked was, how can I experience driving a motorcycle? There's a subtle difference in that question, but it drives home the importance of asking the right question. What's the right question to ask? And so, when I talk about innovation, I often talk about understanding what that question is. We have to spend time asking the question, and we often need to spend time asking the question, not by ourselves. Now, a lot of people think innovation happens in somebody's garage someplace, but a lot of innovation happens very differently, and I'd like to show you what I mean by that.
For the past 5 years, I've been investigating this question of where good ideas come from. It's the kind of problem I think all of us are intrinsically interested in. We want to be more creative, we want to come up with better ideas, we want our organizations to be more innovative. I've looked at this problem from an environmental perspective. What are the spaces that have historically led to unusual rates of creativity and innovation? And what I've found in all of these systems, there are these recurring patterns that you see again and again that are crucial to creating environments that are unusually innovative. One pattern I call the slow hunch. That breakthrough ideas almost never come in a moment of great insight, in a sudden stroke of inspiration. Most important ideas take a long time to evolve, and they spend a long time dormant in the background. It isn't until the idea has had 2 or 3 years, sometimes 10 or 20 years, to mature, that it suddenly becomes accessible to you and useful to you in a certain way. And this is partially because good ideas normally come from the collision between smaller hunches, so that they form something bigger than themselves. So you see a lot in the history of innovation, cases of someone who has half of an idea. There's a great story about the invention of the World Wide Web and Tim Berners-Lee. This is a project that Berners-Lee worked on for 10 years. But when he started, he didn't have a full vision for this new medium he was going to invent. He started working on one project as a side project to help him organize his own data. He scrapped that after a couple years, and he started working on another thing. And only after about 10 years did the full vision of the World Wide Web come into being. That is, more often than not, how ideas happen. They need time to incubate, and they spend a lot of time in this partial hunch form. The other thing that's important when you think about ideas this way is that when ideas take form in this hunch state, they need to collide with other hunches. Oftentimes, the thing that turns a hunch into a real breakthrough is another hunch that's lurking in somebody else's mind. And you have to figure out a way to create systems that allow those hunches to come together and turn into something bigger than the sum of their parts. That's why, for instance, the coffee house in the Age of the Enlightenment or the Parisian salons of modernism were such engines of creativity, because they created a space where ideas could mingle and swap and create new forms. When you look at the problem of innovation from this perspective, it sheds a lot of important light on the debate we've been having recently about what the internet is doing to our brains. Are we getting overwhelmed with an always connected multitasking lifestyle? And is that going to lead to less sophisticated thoughts as we move away from the slower, deeper, contemplative state of reading, for instance? Obviously, I'm a big fan of reading, but I think it's important to remember that the great driver of scientific innovation and technological innovation has been the historic increase in connectivity, in our ability to reach out and exchange ideas with other people, and to borrow other people's hunches and combine them with our hunches and turn them into something new. That really has, I think, been, more than anything else, the primary engine of creativity and innovation over the last 600 or 700 years. And so yes, it's true we're more distracted. But what has happened that is really miraculous and marvelous over the last 15 years is that we have so many new ways to connect and so many new ways to reach out and find other people who have that missing piece that will complete the idea we're working on, or to stumble serendipitously across some amazing new piece of information that we can use to build and improve our own ideas. That's the real lesson of where good ideas come from, that chance favors the connected mind.
Chance favors the connected mind. Stephen Johnson actually does a wonderful TED talk that runs on for about 18 minutes that talks about this in a little bit more detail, and I encourage you to watch it. He's also written a very good book called Where Good Ideas Come From. But the concept of innovation, the concept of the way we actually get things done, is to actually be connected. So what does being connected look like? Well, I tend to think of it as domains of interest, and let me just show you what I mean by that. These are my current domains of interest. I play with this slide every couple of months, and if you looked at my slide 6 months ago, a year ago, it wouldn't have looked quite like this. But this is how I see myself, and this is how I see my domains of interest right now. There's nursing up in the left-hand corner. There is and always will be A&A in my life. Nursing is central to who I am and how I define myself. My family, my friends, my activities, outdoors, animals, horses. I love music. I love live theater. And in the center there, you see the attempt to balance. A couple of years ago, that would not have even made it on the slide. It's on the slide now, and it's getting bigger. And I'm glad of that, it's getting bigger. But in 6 months' time or a year's time, that might look different. So let me introduce you to somebody that many of you in the room here know, Professor Peggy Chin, Dr. Peggy Chin, who is the editor of Advances in Nursing Science. This is Peggy's current list of domains of interest. She and I talked about it. I have permission to share this. If you will go to her website, you'll see all of this. She has a lot of domains of interest. So the question is, if you were to do a slide today of yourself, what would your domains of interest look like? And when I talk about a domain of interest, let me capture that for you a little bit. I mean something that you would engage in on a weekly basis, something that if there was an article about, you would read that rather than something else, something that you have a bit of knowledge or a real intense interest in learning more about. Most of us, when we draw this, if we're really honest, you know, you're a spouse, you've got children, you've got a full-time job, you've got maybe church, you might have one or two activities, and so it gets easy to let our world get smaller and smaller because the content that we're working on is so intense. But if you only have three or four domains of interest, then what I would encourage you to understand is that chance favors the connected mind. The connected mind. And so the more domains of interest we have, the more connected we are going to be. The more we are going to look beyond what our normal course of interest is to find and engage others in conversations to help us think from a different perspective about issues and problems that we're struggling with. For years and years and years, nurses believed at their core that if they'd nursed long enough, they were going to have a bad back. It went with the territory. We got hurt. We believed that that was the case. There's nobody else in any other industry that thinks that moving a little 100-pound lady by ourselves in bed is an okay thing to do. People working on assembly lines in Detroit do not lift more than 35 pounds. Construction workers have assistance to lift weights. When ANA kicked off its safe patient handling campaign, I met with an ergonomist who said to me, "What took you so long?" And I said, "I don't understand what you're asking me." And I said, "What took you so long to come to us to help you solve this problem?" We can solve this problem. We've solved it in every other industry. We never thought to go. We always believed that that was what we had to do. But chance favors the connected mind. And we hadn't connected. We need to. So I encourage you, quietly, nobody else has to see it. You can put it away. You don't have to share it with anybody. But I invite you to create your own slide and see what's on there. And see what you think about perhaps maybe broadening that. Because chance favors the connected mind. The other question is, I believe we can teach people to be more innovative. You know, there's some people that believe, oh, well, he's just always very creative. Well, creativity and being creative is not the same as being innovative, number one. But number two, we can learn to do this better. But we have to first understand what the skill sets are. And so Jeff Dwyer and Brigham and Hal Gersten did a six-year study in the late 90s. 3,000 creative executives that they identified, and they did individual interviews. And they came up with what they described as five discovery skills of what really innovative leaders do. I'm going to briefly summarize them for you. Creative leaders are very good at associating. It's a cognitive skill which allows people to make connections across seemingly unrelated industries and questions, problems and ideas. These are people that can connect the dots before most other people recognize that there are dots that are in patterns. But we can learn to do that if we become more observant. These are leaders who are constantly questioning, questions of what if, why, and why not? What's stopping us? Why do we let it stop us? Why do we sit here and believe that it is normal for every nurse to be injured, to have a bad back? They question that. They never let an answer sit. There is always a what if, a why, and a why not. They are closely observant of details, both in how people respond, and people's strengths, abilities, strengths, weaknesses, responsiveness, resilience, and system response. They really understand how systems work. Thank you, Marion. They really understand how systems work and how people behave within systems. These are the folks that are always trying new experiments. As soon as they get something working really well, they decide it's time to change it. It's a constant changing pattern. It's a constant way of looking at, we can always find a better way. Innovation history is filled with organizations, leaders in industries who chose not to do that because they believe that what got them to be in first place would keep them in first place. And the bottom line is, there is no longer an RCA victor. There is no longer industries like that who believe that the technology that got them to be the leader in their field would keep them there. And so really creative, really innovative leaders know that and understand that they can never be satisfied with what is in place. They must always be looking for what is new, what is cutting edge, what will drive their industry further. And they look beyond their own industries to find that. So they experiment, and they're always looking at new worlds. These are the people who network like crazy. There isn't a person that they meet anywhere that they don't somehow figure out how to network. These are the people who collect business cards at a meeting like this and flip it over and write on the back so that they reach out and they know why they want to connect with that person. If they don't do it at the meeting, they do it immediately after the meeting. They're exceptionally good at networking, and they are very good at networking outside of their own industry. to find other people that might have other perspectives who can bring new ideas and different perspectives to solving a problem. They don't work in silos. They don't live their industries in silos. They don't allow their organizations to remain in silos. They reach out because chance favors the connected mind. Chance favors the connected mind. If you go to a party, how many of you go to a party and all the nurses gather over here and the lawyers gather over there? The next time, break out of that mold. Go talk to somebody who you have no idea of their work and ask them questions. Describe an issue or a problem and watch and see what perspective they might bring, because it is in that arena and in that way that we actually get innovative ideas. Experts in certain fields are not the right people often to ask the question, because the way they ask the question is dependent on their knowledge base and their belief that their expertise is the expertise that will answer the question. Remember when I showed you the first video, if that gentleman had asked the question, how do I drive a motorcycle when I'm blind, versus how do I have the experience of riding a motorcycle? If it asked the first question, he never would have gotten to that motorcycle. Understanding how to ask the right question and the fact that it takes much more time to frame the question well than it is sometimes to find the answer is important. We have mathematicians today that are working on mathematical modeling of how cancer cells divide. They may find some solutions to cancer that our oncologists sitting in healthcare environments will not recognize. We must be willing to reach out and do that. We must also be willing to simplify. Now, here we have a harmonica. And a harmonica is a very interesting little instrument. Small, you can put it in your pocket. Now, there are 8 notes to the scale, 8. There are 10 holes in a harmonica. So that's a little bit of a problem. But how many times do we think about what we do as nurses? And we think we do simple things. First of all, please understand that simple is not easy. Simple is often hard, and simple can be elegant. Vernice Ferguson, who was a wonderful nursing leader in the VA system, who was a major government official, who was often both the first woman and the first nurse to serve in positions of importance in our government, used to say that nursing practice done well was elegant. And she often referenced the simplest things done elegantly. We have a couple of minutes, and I want you to see a harmonica player.
This is Buddy Green. There are a lot of folks, Buddy, who look at that fine little instrument that you play and say,
so what? Ho-hum. And I understand it's kind of gotten a bad rap down through the years, you know? Grandpa's played with it, kind of like. You know, and that just goes so far, Bill. You don't want to bring that kind of harmonica into Carnegie Hall. Now's the time to get sophisticated. And Bill, I've been waiting for this moment all my life. So just help me make the most of it. Just back up just a little bit. Stay perfectly still here.
Thank you.
You want to be careful how you encourage a harmonica player.
The point is that something simple, used with great skill, can be very elegant, can be very complex. The idea of innovation, at least in healthcare, in my opinion, is to be able to look at complexity, make it simple, make it elegant, make it do something on behalf of our patients. A lot of what we do looks simple, but as you all know, it's not. That's why innovation is important. That's why the work that we do is important. That's why this college is important, and it's why this university is important. For many people in this room, this university and this college and the faculty here have given us opportunities and chances that have helped us reach where we have reached today. Many of us would not have been able to accomplish what we did if it wasn't for the start that this university gave us and that this school gave us. So for all of you who are here tonight who are graduates, first of all, welcome home. Welcome back. Remember the university. Remember the school. Remember what it allowed and supported you to do. And then turn around, reach into your heart, reach into your head, and reach back to this university and to this school and find ways to support it so that it can continue to support young people who want the same opportunities that we wanted, who will take advantage of the same opportunities we took advantage of. And we will have make a difference in this community, in this city, in this state, and in this country. So thank you all very much for being here and for allowing me to be part of this evening's events.
We still have a lot of fun that's going to be handled by our Associate Dean, Marion Winfrey. And if it wasn't her, I probably wouldn't have taken the job. She has been great in supporting me and the faculty and the students, and have been here for a while. A lot of you will remember her. She's got so much to say in the next 35 minutes. So tune in. Marion?
Well, welcome, everybody. And Dean Kulwicki is right. I came here in 1990. Brenda Cherry, Pearl Rosendahl, I sent out a resume. I had a brand new doctorate, and I was ready to save the world. And they let me. What I'm going to do is give some history of the college. I spent some time with Fran Portnoy the other night, and Linda Dumas is right, the food is delicious at Orchard Cove. And I am going to be, at the beginning, I'll give you more facts, but as it goes along, I think you're going to enjoy what you see and have a good time with it, because I absolutely did myself. My dissertation, while I put this together, was actually on college mergers in 1989. So I did actually study the merger of what eventually became UMass Boston. But going back, how did we get here? Boston City Hospital, Boston State College, University of Massachusetts, and then Exercise and Health Sciences tried to use up the alphabet by going through the Department of Physical Education, Human Performance and Fitness when I got here, Exercise Science and Physical Education, which SP is still on the books, and now Exercise and Health Sciences. So it's been an interesting route to where we are today. But how did all of this start? It started with Linda Richards and even with Mary Eliza Mahoney and Boston City Hospital, putting together a program of nursing to help those who were in need, because you only went to a hospital if you had no other choice. And then came the city of Boston and its rapid growth in the 70s and 80s. Those of you remember the Weyerhaeuser building? They called the John Hancock Weyerhaeuser because that was the brand of paneling that they put up every time a window blew out. But Boston State, how did we get there? It started with Ann Hargreaves taking over as the director of nursing at Boston City Hospital and nursing education, and asked a consultant by the name of Ann Kibrick to come and help out. And the two of them realized that it's time for Boston City Hospital School of Nursing to grow out. Boston City Hospital had had lots of financial problems. It was under warnings by JACO. They were in a tremendous deficit. And they seized the moment. They made the difference. They didn't say, we're just going to disappear and go away. We're going to evolve into something bigger and something better. And at the same time, Boston State said, we think we want to go and open up a nursing school. Back then, nursing schools were a cash cow. Today, I think it's a little lean sometimes, but back then, many schools opened up nursing programs, and Boston State was among them. And Ann Hargreaves, Ann Kibrick put this together and actually in 1973 signed a joint agreement in which liberal arts courses would go, the students would go to Boston State, but they take their nursing at Boston City. And Ann was there. Ann, and innovation. And why were they so different? Actually, Boston at the time was one of the last major cities that did not have a public baccalaureate school of nursing. Hard to imagine, but you know what, folks? Today, UMass Boston is still the only public Baccalaureate School of Nursing in the city of Boston. Now, Boston University didn't like this at all. Silber went to the legislature, President Silber, and said, it'll be a lot cheaper if you just give my nursing students scholarships rather than open up a public school of nursing. And Ann Hargreaves and Ann Kibrick said, no, because this is what we want nursing to look like. And that's not who you're bringing into your colleges and universities. So how do you open a college? Well, you gotta get some equipment. And so you went to Spars. And I actually remember I came here in 73, and where do you go? You go there. Then you gotta find, besides Boston City, you gotta find some other hospitals that will take your students. And the students at Boston State were different. Do you know that only 30% of nursing schools at that time even taught health assessment? But Boston State did, because you had Ann, and innovation. So you had Boston City. Oh, and Boston City. And you had Boston City. And the lying in. And all of the students went to these places as well as Children's Hospital. And Ethel Kanaxis greeted many a student. I'm not sure if it was an omen, but the day I started at UMass was her last day at UMass. And excellent faculty. Many of you remember Sylvia Gendrop. And part of this was the brilliance of Ann Kibrick to say, my faculty will be doctorally prepared. Her first two faculty were Kent Champourian, who was doctorally prepared, and Joyce Passos, who was doctorally prepared and had just had the third edition of her clinical nursing textbook published. So we might have been public at the time, but we were excellent public. This is the mail page. That's Bob Guimond and Myron Siegelman. Eddie, he is handsome in the picture here. So that, if you survived these two guys, you got through your A&P, your pathophysiology, and your pharmacology. Gail Arnold, who was at that time, she was chairperson of physical education. Jackie Haslett, who was in charge of the education department. I swear, Jackie Haslett's office, every file for every student was in Jackie's office. I couldn't find Jackie, but I could find the files. And there you have Judy Lewis and Peg Anderson, who also were nursing faculty. And Anne, who taught just like any other dean would do, she was in there teaching. And just like today, there is no space for classrooms. They met where they could meet and did what they needed to do. There were classrooms, and there was the lab. And both the nursing and the phys ed had to learn how to do CPR. And they kept working away at CPR. And working, and sometimes got a little carried away doing CPR, but they finally got it. And they learned in these labs that were primitive, but it was the spirit of the faculty that moved people along. And I sure hope that on a real patient, you don't have the chest tubes up there. But this was simulation learning at its best, because they were using the facilities at Boston City, which had just built a nursing education building. This a little scared of the simulation experience. She was pretending to be a tired mommy. I went to school in the city in New York, and believe me, this is exactly the way it is. You go to class and you come out of class and you get at least one parking ticket. But it's time to say goodbye to hubby. That's one of the CPR. And move on to school. Or you're living with a roommate and put each other's uniforms on by mistake. But you're going to get to clinical no matter what. And I understand that the students took great pride in their nursing uniforms. It really was a symbol of their being and being public and being Boston State. And there was an innovative program there. There were two innovative programs besides health assessment. One was that they followed a family in community health. And after one semester, the next semester, another group of students would take on that faculty and truly have an experience. And later on, I'll talk about who they look to for guidance about nursing. And then there's Mary Hennessy and the groundbreaking work in which she took nursing students to Pine Street Inn and flourished there, and a nursing-run clinic was there. And this is Mary Hennessy with her nursing students at Pine Street Inn, because at that time, who would go to a shelter like that? But Boston State did. But now you've got, near the end of the road, you've got to study for the boards. And you've got to study for the boards. And it looks just the same today, minus the hat, plus the uniform. I don't think you wear the clinic shoes. My God, do you remember the clinic shoes? Oh, they would not wear out. They just wouldn't wear out. And to become an alumna, it's time to graduate and move on. Because by now you've acquired enough parking tickets that you're really glad you're going to UMass Boston now, because there is parking and you won't be collecting any more tickets. The story of accreditation is very interesting. The group came to accredit in 1978 in February. They landed here, they got into the hotel, and did not leave for a week because the blizzard of 78 kept them in the hotel for a week. No traveling, they never got to the school, and another group had to come at another time to actually do the first accreditation visit. But here is, I keep everything, I'm like a pack rat. I hope you can see this. This is a 1986 self-study report in which we had 279 full-time baccalaureate nurses, 289 part-time nursing students, 4 full-time tenured faculty. These were people, these faculty, these resources, this was a commitment to excellence. And as Barbara would say, to elegance. As Ann Kibrick moved on, we had another visionary in Dean Brenda Cherry, who came from George Mason. She, like Ann, who told her faculty, get your doctorate. We opened a master's degree program and a doctoral program. And state-of-the-art new lab, that was our new lab here at UMass Boston. If you go into the research area, that's where the lab used to be. State-of-the-art, we had a big screen TV. My office was on the other side of that wall. If I heard the video on how to bathe the patient one more time, And they were excited about a new lab, too. But exercise and health sciences, which at that point was physical education, they also moved. They had a groundbreaking report. They did their AQUAD report, which is a report on quality and assessment. They closed their education program, their physical education, coaching, and took the program that they now have. You could tell the nursing students from the exercise and health science students, and that is Kyle McGinnis, who was one of the department chairpersons. He and I came at the same time. Oh, yeah. And this was their faculty. Carmen Bazzano, holding the glass, taught statistics with an Italian accent. Judy Bourne and Pete Seder. They were all wonderful faculty. And the interesting thing about the EHS faculty is that they couldn't get past the podium. but they also taught dance as well as exercise and health sciences. Some of our folks are not with us anymore, like Sylvia Gendrop. But we had great, great times. And looking through this, someone said, did we just celebrate all the time? And that was a faculty meeting. And you see on the side, you see Jane Clutterbuck, who had been teaching over at Roxbury. And Grace Garner, who was teaching here. Imagine a public baccalaureate nursing program, master's and doctoral program that had an African-American dean and three African-American doctorally prepared nursing faculty. This is what Ann and innovation was all about. Christy Alster and Mary O'Brien, who was the associate dean before me, Cindy Aber, and Ann. Ann didn't leave, it didn't matter. She never left us. And Maggie McAllister, Diane Gillis. They really grew Sigma Theta Tau on this campus. They really were the pioneers of getting this going, having it become an important part of the College of Nursing and Health Sciences. And there's one of their first speakers was Jackie Fawcett, who came under Brenda Cherries. And Judy Beal, I knew you were coming. And you came and spoke at Sigma as well. So as health sciences became more integrated, they led the way. Because, well, they were good-looking guys. And Fran Portnoy, dear Fran. Fran Portnoy was the innovator of so many programs in community health and partnerships, and came back over and over again to help with accreditation reports and advising. And Ted Kennedy was one of our friends as well. And he came to one of our fundraising dinners with his wife of 2 years, Vicki. So we have always attracted people interested in healthcare. Linda Dumas, Mary Hennessy with their groundbreaking work at Pine Street. Joyce Clifford, who worked with Ann Kibrick to develop the nursing program here. Primary nursing, the way to look at your patients in a holistic way. And Fran and her lovely Harry. And you see there one of the former chancellors, Sherry Penny, who really loved the nursing and exercise and health sciences. Who's that lady? I think it must be Barbara Blakeney. So today we have a huge college. We've been innovative. We've moved forward. We've made a difference in the city of Boston, because Ann Hargreaves and Ann Kibrick said, look, these are the people who are committed to this city. They live in this city, their families are here, and the health of this city means something to them. They're not coming here and going away. And we're so glad that today we have a bit more than four exercise and health science faculty or nursing faculty. And we have simulation, and we have Go Kids, and we have the promise of tomorrow, because these people, Greer Glazer, Brenda Cherry, Anahid Kowicki, and Ann Kibrick, are visionaries. This is the nostalgia, but this is the story of why we're all here today. This is Boston City. This is UMass. Thank you.
So I'm Ron Iannotti, the current chair of the Department of Exercise and Health Sciences, and Rosanna and I will be presenting awards. Samantha White graduated magna cum laude in 2013 with a double major in exercise and health sciences and biology. She currently teaches at the Youth to Health Careers program at the Boston Area Health Education Center. This program was formed with the goal of increasing the pool of health professionals in medically underserved and underrepresented areas of Boston. It offers middle and high school students a variety of health, career, and education programs designed to introduce them and prepare them for careers in health. During her time at UMass Boston, Samantha was deemed one of the most effective and admired tutors. Year after year, students praise her effective teaching skills and passionate concerns for their academic welfare and success. As a result, Samantha was awarded the Bettina Hall Harrison Award for Teaching at the 2013 commencement ceremony. She recently obtained her EMT license and is a current medical student applicant. She hopes to continue her lifelong commitment and passion for teaching, learning, and medicine in medical school next year. In recognition of passion and commitment to education, the University of Massachusetts Boston is proud to present Samantha White with the Distinguished Alumni Award for Excellence in Teaching. Samantha? Patricia Noga graduated in 2011 from the PhD program in nursing with high distinction. Dr. Noga currently is the Vice President of Clinical Affairs at the Massachusetts Hospital Association, where she leads the implementation of the MHA's statewide performance improvement agenda, focusing on statewide initiatives to improve quality, efficiency, and safety. Dr. Noga also leads a statewide implementation of the National Quality Improvement Collaborative in Massachusetts hospitals. The Partnership for Patients, in conjunction with the American Hospital Association's Hospital Research and Education Trust. Dr. Noga's research informs the safety area of the quality and safety education for nurses and for advanced practice nurses. Her area of interest includes patients' falls, care transitions, and advancing quality and safety among healthcare settings. Dr. Noga's knowledge and application of the theoretical and methodological aspects of health policy are advancing appreciation of nurses' contribution to dialogue about the most important issues in healthcare systems by all members of healthcare teams. She has published in the Nursing Administration Quarterly and Health Affairs Journals and has delivered numerous talks during and following her graduation from UMass Boston. She is outstanding among our alumni for her contributions as a nursing leader and her role in promoting policies to advance healthcare quality and safety. In recognition of passion and commitment to nursing research, the University of Massachusetts Boston is proud to present Patricia Noga with the Distinguished Alumni Award for Excellence in Research. Patricia? And now I'd like to introduce Rosanna DeMarco, who is the chair of the Department of Nursing.
Good evening. It's my honor and pleasure now to give out two more prestigious awards. Thank you, Ron. Susan Gavigan is a clinical nurse specialist on an acute care inpatient unit at Massachusetts General Hospital. As a nurse leader, Susan is extremely dedicated to the professional growth of her staff and the development of a team which fosters high-quality nursing care and positive patient outcomes. Susan is a certified wound specialist, allowing her to serve on an inpatient unit as a consultant, enhancing and influencing nursing practice, establishing educational and competency standards, and supporting new staff. Susan is involved in many hospital-wide committees where she excels in sharing her expertise in order to positively impact the care provided by nurses hospital-wide. Susan has been the recipient of the prestigious Partners in Excellence Awards for her efforts on the CNS Wound Development Program and the Tracheostomy Care Quality Team, as well as for developing a respiratory orientation. Susan has had the opportunity to present at multiple national conferences and has published several articles related to enhanced practice while being in the CNS role. In recognition of passion and commitment to nursing practice, the University of Massachusetts Boston is proud to present Susan Gavigan with the Distinguished Alumni Award for Excellence in Practice. Susan? And the final award I'll be giving out this evening goes to Tim Quigley. Tim Quigley is Vice President of Nursing Services and Chief Nursing Officer at South Shore Hospital. A passionate and effective advocate for lifelong learning and shared governance as tools to empower caregivers so that they may better serve patients, South Shore Hospital achieved its initial designation as prestigious magnet hospital under his leadership. Reaching this designation is the result of several years of preparation and longstanding commitments in nursing and patient care through quality and process improvements, as well as interdisciplinary collaboration. Mr. Quigley is a board member of the Organization of Nurse Leaders in Massachusetts and Rhode Island, and was a recipient of their Mary B. Concession Leadership Award in 2013. He is also an active board member of the Boston EMS Regional Council and the UMass Boston College of Nursing and Health Sciences. In recognition of his distinguished service and leadership, the University of Massachusetts Boston is proud to present Timothy Quigley with the distinguished, I can't say that word. Let me say that one more time, because it's very distinguished. The Distinguished Alumni Award for Commitment to Service. Tim. He said he wants that picture to go to his wife. And now back to Dean Kulwicki.
Did you have a good time? Thank you. I sure learned a great deal, and I want to take this opportunity to thank our first dean, Ann Kibrick, for showing us or leading us to the way where we are now. So, can we honor her with the bouquet of flowers? I didn't know I was going to have a lot of exercise while doing this, but I'm glad I did. I would like to express my thanks to those who have joined us here tonight. Through your support, you not only pay tribute to Boston's only public university, you help ensure that future generations of learners have access to the wonderful opportunity of higher education. Thank you all for being here tonight and helping us honor the College of Nursing and Health Sciences. I encourage you to continue your involvement, and I look forward to seeing you at the next College of Nursing and Health Sciences event. Thank you. And I just also wanted to do some housekeeping that the coat rack is moved from the first floor to the third floor. So if you brought your coats and you were cold today, so that's where you're going to find. Good night.